briefly, what is my objective? And the last two lines are what I really want to do. I want to argue for models that are multi-level and multi-scale in subsystems, space, and time. And as a consequence of previous presentations, I skip something and start. I wanted to give you a more detailed history of urban models, but I skip this and just show you the situation in the 1980s and the situation today. And I don't even know whether I have been able to put in all the presumably emerging Chinese models. Yeah, so that is what I want to start with, that there is a trend in urban modeling on the horizontal axis, and I owe this presentation to Eric Miller, that on the horizontal axis you have levels of disaggregation from very crude to very fine on the right-hand side, and the same is on the vertical axis, yeah, from very crude to activity-based land use model. And what is happening is that everything is concentrating in the lower right corner, which means that in this last right corner, you have Ilute, Ilumas, Urban Sim, yeah, and only very few models really manage this full integration, yeah? And that is my point of departure, because not all of these modeling projects which try to pick up the trend to disaggregation were successful. Many large modeling projects failed to deliver in the time available or had to reduce their ambitious goals. Many applications of established models by others than their authors, we discussed it already, did not become operational. Many projects got lost in data collection and calibration and did not reach the state of policy analysis. Many projects remained in the academic environment and produced only PhD theses. And many microsimulation, which means activity or agent-based projects, ignored the pitfalls of stochastic variation and produced results with illusionary precision. I will come back to this very soon. Well, as an example, I was asked by Rolf and also by Kai Nagel to really give you one example of a German integrated microsimulation model called ILOMAS, Integrated Land Use Modeling and Transport System Simulation. Yeah, and this project combined a microscopic activity-based simulation model of urban traffic flows and a microscopic agent-based model of household and firm development and the resulting changes of land and housing markets and a model of environmental impacts. So very, very ambitious. It was conducted by a number of German university institutions. Now this was a flow diagram where you started with land use, yeah, and with transport and environmental impacts. And I cannot go into details. It is really very complex, yeah? And this was the dimension, 1.2 million households, 2.6 million persons, 1.2 million dwellings, 80,000 firms, 92,000 industrial sites, 8,400 public transport links, 848 public transport lines, 13,000 road links, and so on and so on. And look at the lowest line, 3 to 5 days of computing time. Now, that, of course, was a problem. But nevertheless, I show you a number of, let's say, visualizations. For instance, the generation of new firms and new households, and through time, this worked like that. Just a visualization, nothing else. Or the demographic birth and death. I think this was done by Rolf. Is that correct? Yeah? He was responsible not only for the synthetic population, but also for a number of submodels. Yeah? And the dwellings or demolitions of dwellings. And finally, the moves of households in the housing market were distinguished of out-migration, immigration, new household, and moves. And that was what we have here. But the end of Elon Musk was also imminent. Yeah, because the project was quite successful in developing individual submodels, but it was not successful in implementing the planned integrated model. Yeah, because the land use, transport, and environment submodels were independent executables. The application programming interface connecting submodels via files, yeah, never worked properly. Data exchange between submodels was slow, and the computing times, in particular of the transport submodels, took days for each year. Yeah, and of course, we wanted to model 50 years. Yeah. At the end of the project, the Dortmund group decided to replace the microscopic transport and environment submodels by the aggregate transport model of the Irput model. I will talk about that in a second. And by simpler environmental impact models, the resulting little Elon Musk model consisted of only two executables and took only 90 minutes for the whole 30-year simulation. Right. Now, a few words about the benefits and pitfalls of microsimulation. Yeah, because the activity-based microsimulation, yeah, improved urban simulation model. Lifestyles could be represented. This means households and individuals could be disaggregated down to the agent level, and we had examples already in previous presentations today. Environmental impact and feedback could be modeled with the required spatial resolution. And population and employment could be represented by the decision-making units, which means households and firms. And micro-locations could be represented. Households affected by environmental impacts could be localized. All this sounds very nice. However, to date, no full-scale micro-simulation model of urban land use, transport, and environment combined has become operational. Please contradict me if I missed something. There are still unresolved problems regarding the interfaces between the submodels. The feedback between transport and environmental quality and location has not yet been implemented. The computing time for existing models is calculated in terms of weeks or days, not hours. And serious problems of calibration, instability, and random fluctuations have not yet been solved. And here is an example of a paper I wrote in 2011 in Transport Reviews, yeah, which shows the, negative impact of a stochastic variation, which is, as I found out, a function of the relationship between the number of choices which are modeled and the number of alternatives, yeah, which are available. And in this case, you see, you have many choices and a small number of alternatives, each one represented by a square in this little diagram. And you see, the errors are relatively minor. If you go to 400 alternatives, reduce the number of squares, yeah, then, of course, the standard deviation is already becoming quite critical. And if you reduce all this to 900 alternatives, you get complete chaos. Yeah, and as I said, this paper by me was completely ignored, consistently ignored by the profession, because it really put a question mark against all microsimulation approaches. Okay, there are ultimate limits to increasing the substantive, spatial, and temporal resolution of behavioral models. There are theoretical limits when the number of processes simulated is too small to yield reliable results. There are empirical limits when the marginal cost of obtaining microdata are larger than their added value. There are practical limits when the computing time of the models exceeds the duration of the modeled processes. And there are, last but not least, ethical limits to the collection of data about private lives for the purposes of only research. How much micro is enough? There seems to be little consideration of the benefits and costs of microsimulation. Where is microsimulation really needed? What is the price for microsimulation? Would a more aggregate model do? And for the models we are talking about, spatial planning models, the answer to these questions depends on the planning task at hand. And I will now really propose instead, let's say, a kind of theory of multi-level, multi-scale models. And the title page of my presentation, which I repeat here, is an example which I use to demonstrate that. On the left-hand side, you have a model of the whole of Europe, yeah, modeling the economic and population development of European regions. In the middle, you have the urban region of Dortmund in this case, yeah, and there you have also regions, and in the outer ring you have municipalities. And on the right-hand side, you have the detailed raster cell resolution, which you use for certain environmental modeling tasks. Now, multi-level is from European to the urban, and multi-scale is when you increase the resolution. Now, I give you now a very brief account of how we implemented that. Yeah, and I think 5 minutes is possible, yeah? Okay. This is our European model, the so-called SASI model, and I very quickly run through its element. We start with European transport policy. You have accessibility. You have a production function, which creates GDP for the European regions. And then this creates employment. And that, of course, creates income. That creates the migration function. And finally, you have population and labor force and unemployment. Now, that gives scenarios for the development of Europe, and I cannot explain them. You see, our urban region, Dortmund, is in the middle somewhere, and you have a scenario A1, B1, and C1. I don't explain them. You can imagine they are differ from the economic success. Yeah. Now, on the medium, the regional level, we have our input model, which I mentioned before. And again, I quickly go through that. These arrows now are the input from the higher level, yeah, down to the regional level. I think in the Oregon, this is a net model linked to the regional level. Yeah. And here you have population and households, and you have employment and workplaces on the other side. You have residential buildings and, of course, non-residential buildings. And these are the stocks of the system. Yeah, in between, you have markets, which links population and residential buildings, and the same is on the left-hand side. You have the market for non-residential buildings. You have the labor market, we talked about that, and you have the land market, and last but not least, you have the transport market. A footnote, we do, even now, still use micro-simulation of the Monte Carlo type for modeling the housing market, but only that, nothing else. Okay, and these are typical scenarios. Yeah, I can only quickly go through this because I don't have the time, where we, for instance, vary price of petrol, gas at the gas station. Yeah, and you see this goes from 160 euro per liter to 333 and 680, and together with other policies, we end up finally with really something very cruel, 23 euro per liter. And these are the scenarios: do nothing, business as usual, infrastructure and technology and demand regulation and all policies. I don't have the time, as you can imagine. This is just a typical output, CO2 emission by transport per capita per day, and we can compare that with political targets, minus 20, minus 30, minus 40, and you can see that we can only partly achieve these targets. And finally, the lowest level, which is a grid cell or raster model, written by Klaus Spickermann, and that is indeed taking the output of the regional model and translating them into very detailed environmental impacts, such as resource use, emissions, air quality, traffic noise, and environmental quality. Now, that is then the typical output of that kind of model, which really is very high-resolution raster-based. Now, new challenges, because that's fine up to this point. But now we are in a situation where our situation changes fundamentally, and I just list things, you know them yourselves. Mitigation of climate change or adaptation to climate change. And do you know any of the urban models available worldwide who really can deal with all of these elements or factors, or energy scarcity, and social conflicts, and finally, very recent new car sharing, new technologies such as car sharing, online shopping, or self-driving cars. My question is, do we really deal with these new challenges? And my answer is rather not. Yeah, I would like to give you a little glimpse of the work of my colleagues and me in the last 3 years, the Ruhr model. And tomorrow, I will have to present these results in more detail to the funding agency. But this was the much larger part of our home state, the Ruhr area, which is very polycentric, as you can see from this graph. This is the transport network. This is the relatively detailed zonal system. And that is the raster cell system, which I talked about. The yellow is the area of our previous model. Yeah, and now what is the difference? You know this already. Well, that is the difference, that we are now looking at all the points, in the urban system, including transportation, in which energy and CO2 emissions can be addressed. I should mention at this point that this model differs from most other urban models, that the transport model is fully integrated. All this, what you see here, is one executable, written in, the most efficient optimization language available today, Fortran. Very old, but Intel Fortran is indeed the fastest computer language you can have at the moment. And so this is why we did not choose Java or Python or whatever. Right, now these are just typical outputs, such as, for instance, density of energy retrofitted residential buildings in the year 2050, or stationless car sharing, where is it concentrated, and so on. Of course, I could do discuss that. I will end up, broad comparison of the scenarios, and if you can read the vertical description of the scenarios, you see this really goes through all these fields, action fields of urban and regional planning, and in the right, on the right-hand side, you can see combinations. Yeah, we call them integrated strategies. 81 deals with urban form, 82 with energy efficiency, 83 with push methods to make car traffic less attractive, 84 with pull measures to make public transport, cycling and walking more attractive, and then 85 all policies, or 86 selective policies, and you see that reduces CO2 emissions of all policies by about 75%. Not bad, is it? Right. Conclusions. And that is only two slides. The fundamental changes in the problems and priorities of urban planning we are going to face in the future will have deep impacts on the philosophy and method of urban modeling. Less detail, more basic essentials. Less extrapolation, more fundamental change. Less equilibrium, more dynamics. Less observed behavior, more theory on needs. We had that already. Less preferences and choices, and more constraints. Less calibration, more plausibility analysis. Less forecasting, more backcasting. Don't ask what can be done, but what needs to be done. And my last slide. Multi-level, multi-scale models might be a solution to these problems, because these considerations lead to a reassessment of the hypothesis that in the future, all spatial modeling will be microscopic and agent-based. Under constraints of data collection and computing time, there is for each planning problem an optimum level of conceptual, spatial, and temporal resolution. This suggests to work towards a theory of balanced multi-level models, which are as complex as necessary for the planning task at hand, and, to quote Albert Einstein, as simple as possible, but no simpler. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Very nice presentation. Super. The floor is open.
No questions.
I start with a question. Just want to be polite. So you said at the beginning that one problem of our models is that they become more and more complex. So we add a lot of complexity that increases run times and makes them unwieldy, very difficult to handle. At the same time, you presented that also in this project, you developed in this rural area project, you developed a highly complex model and you added a lot of aspects to the modeling system. So my question is, how do you decide how much complexity you add to the model? Where do you decide this is a line I don't cross, this is something I will not add, but other things you do add? How do you make this decision?
Good question. I would answer that you really start with the relevance and urgency of the problem, and that you trade off between complexity in terms of policies and action possibilities versus complexity in terms of resolution. And I would always opt for including new theoretical and practical insights into the model, and I would sacrifice resolution and detail in terms of zone size and action or agent-based disaggregation. But that is maybe a subjective decision of my colleagues and me, and not everybody may follow this. But I think the history of highly disaggregated models, which I showed and which also Rick Donnelly showed, point into the direction that it may be more important to include, let's say, new types of vehicles or new patterns of, let's say, online shopping or of working at home, telework, etc., etc., than to really go to the extreme in detail. I think I should mention one thing, which I'm sorry, I forgot. And these are 52 different scenarios. Each of them models the region I describe briefly over 60 years, from 1990 to 2050. And each of these scenarios takes 25 times of computing if we use all the possibilities of Intel Fortran optimization, and it's a quite new Intel workstation.
25 minutes, you meant? 25 minutes per
scenario, which means that we can run all the 52 scenarios in one batch lauf overnight, and it takes 21 hours. In one night, all 52 scenarios. Compare that to the 3.5 days the present SWIM2 model takes in Oregon. Yeah? And you have to make a decision between 25 minutes and 3.5 days. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Very impressive presentation, Michael, not least because, partly because it probably saves me from having to give my own presentation on Friday.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I will miss this. I'm not sure
I shall get away with this. I think since you won't be here, you should take heart that your points about stochastic variation and their implications for the reliability of model results have definitely been taken to heart in one group of modelers. The point I wanted to ask about was the multi-level model, the system that you were describing from European to regional to RasterCell. You carefully picked out the downward linkages from European to regional. Do you have connections back up in your case?
A dream we had and have not been able to implement until now, but that would be the next step, yeah, and that would end up with one single executable, but simply because of lack of time and resources, my colleagues and I have not implemented yet this. Yeah. But you are completely right, there are clearly upwards, and in particular, Klaus and I, we always dreamt of implementing what we call environmental feedback, and that is the impact of environmental quality at a low scale on location behavior of households and firms. We have done it a little bit by really crude environmental quality calculations at the regional, the medium level, but the real solution would be to have upwards feedback from the RasterCell model to the zonal model. Oh. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And in that case, perhaps my colleagues and I are, to some extent, living the dream. Sometimes it feels like a nightmare, in that we have at least got feedback from environmental measures in the transport model into land use Yes. And yes. upward feedback from urban to regional level.
That okay. clearly is a goal to achieve, and congratulations if you have already done it. Mm?
Thank you, Michael, for the presentation. And I share your concerns about how much microsimulation and where, even though I talk about microsimulation a lot. You mentioned, the question is, when do we need it or how much detail? I tell my students the reason we microsimulate is the combination of heterogeneity and nonlinearity in people and decision making, but you have mm-hmm. to decide. If the world was linear, we wouldn't aggregate models yeah. would work. So, but I agree that I think we often push things down too deeply, and I think this it really comes to the fore in spatial predictions. I mean, we can microsimulate demographics, and we've actually done quite a bit of stochastic analysis of our demographics model, and even the housing market model. If we ignore where people are locating, so prices, building stock, what we find, at least in our model, the coefficient of variation doesn't grow over time and it's very tolerable. What, frankly, we've been afraid to look at, I think, within ILUT is the spatial. Are we putting the right people in the right place? But we have done some on the travel side of things, and I actually think one of the dirty little secrets in the travel demand literature and profession is we never look at the spatial accuracy of our destination choice models, mm-hmm. Usually because we don't have the data. And we've done some simulation work like on shopping location choices and things, or we've also looked at small office relocations, and it's scary the errors, quote unquote errors, or the variation that you get there relative to what observed data. Just trying to simulate even the estimation data set. The variance is massive, and I think that's an unsolved problem.
A very good point, and I think maybe I was a little bit too opinionated, and I should be more balanced, and there is a trade-off to be made between aggregation and disaggregation. And just to show again this picture that shows that one of our submodels, the housing market model, still is microsimulation, even though we know the problems and the price to be paid for that. So I think it's a good point that you are making that it is in a yes or no decision. It is a question which needs to be discussed and decided upon in each particular policy field. Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Michael, you said in your original model that you had a failure in implementing the API.
Sorry?
That the application program interface yeah. in your initial model yeah. was a failure. But it seems like if we're going to be successful at multi-scale, multi-level models, that it'll put even more pressure on that. So was that a one-time failure, or do you think that's something we don't pay enough attention to, and how might we get around that?
Now, this was a mistake by our team at that time. And I do not doubt that more professional, more efficient solutions might be produced. Yeah, but one thing is very important here, that the land use and the transport model should be really combined in one executable. And this, I think, is not common practice. Yeah, in most cases, the interface between land use and transport is via files, loose coupling, correct? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we decided very early to have an aggregated but multimodal, four-step travel model. With all, let's say, refinements which we know are possible nowadays, and with assignment, iterations, etc., 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 and also the correlation with observed link loads are quite impressive. We have done that earlier, and therefore, I think one of the most important differences of this scheme with many combinations of a land use model and a transport model, which may be even written in different languages, etc., etc., is avoided by this very efficient link within one Fortran executable.
Okay, first Alistair and then Kai.
Okay. Sorry, I've jumped in. We've tried to address the problem of the files passing between models with underpinning everything with a spatial database so that all the models draw from a consistent data set and put their results back into a database along with the parameters that produced those results. So the idea is you can get the final result of your chain of models and then look back to see what all of the stages were that led you to that point. So I don't know whether that, I mean, our models are far simpler than anything you've done here, but that at least allows us to get a handle on how we got to the results that we got and store the data in a kind of coherent way in between.
Are you talking about the Tyndall model system?
Yes.
Yes. Well, I mean, they managed to do this. I do not know anything about computing time and so on. I think the result should be the same if the link is properly done. Yeah. But I think the Tyndall people didn't really publish anything about these technical things, right?
No, still not.
Still not. Although all right. All right.
I am pushing for it.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So I clearly vote for as much unification instead of loose coupling because I think loose coupling has more problems than benefits.
Mm-hmm. So that was an injection, but my proper question was the backcasting that you mentioned.
Yeah.
Have you actually looked at which scenarios, so start with the target and then look at the scenarios
that
achieve it?
The answer is very
it.
Simple. In the earlier project, which still is dealt only with the eastern part of the Ruhr area, the so-called STEPS project, yes. In our present project, no, not yet. Mm-hmm. Simply because of lack of time. Think about €23 per liter price of petrol as a gas station. That is a kind of backcasting, yeah? And it showed, I could show you, but I don't have the time, yeah, that car driving is reduced to emergency vehicles and taxis. Yeah, and there is practically no private car driving anymore. If you imagine that 1 liter of petrol is almost €25, yeah, imagine what the tank filling costs you then. Yeah, it will always be a salary, a monthly salary. Yeah, okay. Enough.
Just one brief.
Yeah, sure.
He has a question as well. If I look at the results you show at the very end, I was wondering to what extent were you tasked to A, budget for this? What would these scenarios cost? And B, to what extent did you model the feedback in the transport sector? What elements of change were feasible in the transport sector for you, for your agents?
Dear Kai, I only need 2 hours to answer your question. Yeah, but simply for the first question, yeah, what was
there
it?
Was the budgeting.
The budgeting, yes. We ignored the cost to the city or to the government. Yeah, we carefully looked into the cost impacts for the users, the travelers, the households, and compared that with our assumptions about the development of transport budgets and housing budgets, etc. But we did not really look into the cost for the city government or the local or the regional government or the state government. Yeah. And the second question is really the complex one. And as we discussed it a little bit yesterday over dinner, we are really adhering to the, action space theory of Thorsten Hegerstrand, yeah, and some, I apologize, let's say, statements by Yaakov Zahavi, which are the basic of the kind of rebound effects, which for everybody very simply states or claims that unless traditional gravity-based travel theory wants us to believe that people minimize travel time and travel cost, and the essence of the opposite meaning is that people maximize something, namely opportunities and encounters and possibilities, and that this means that we have in many cases impacts which, let's say, counteract the environmental intentions of the policies as they were designed. Sorry, this is a short answer. I can't really give you more than that. Yeah. Okay.
Thanks, Michael, for a very interesting presentation. As you may recall, our project for Baltimore-Washington region, we actually used loose coupling.
Uh-huh.
And the reason we did that, because our models were developed in different organizations, and they have their own development paths, so people are using them. So actually, one of the reasons we use loose coupling, just to try to have a system which will continue to be used in later stages, because we knew that these people are using their own models, and they are not going to use our tightly integrated model. So learning about Iluma's project and why it was kind of failed, it brings another concern now that maybe our choice was not as real.
I think you are pointing to an important issue, and I think Rick, when he said you need the developer, and without the developer it doesn't work, and that is a social or, let's say, cooperative element of model development and model use. And I have to admit that what my colleagues and I claim is technocratic. Yeah, it's the engineering point of view who says, well, if we do it, nobody else can do it as well. Yeah, and I completely acknowledge that you point out the institutional aspects that if different institutions, transport, land use, environment, institutions or administrative bodies work together, they believe in their own model and they want to, then the art is really to make this work. And the examples which we heard about speak against this and say it's very difficult, and I think there is the famous example of Urban Sim, which really was not linked properly. Would you like to comment on this? Yeah?
No.
No? Okay. Okay, but it's a good point you are making, and maybe I had to be very simplified in my presentation to only defend the technocratic engineering solution. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.